Pretty hard to drink of the cup when you don't have any. Well, this is definitely a new change up here. We used to have this big oak one, you know. You'd get up here and you'd kind of hide behind it. And then we reduced down to another little thing that was like a small lectern. Now we got a bistro table. Yeah. I don't know what you're doing up here, Joey. Well, today, Jesus, when he was hanging on the cross, of course, I don't know how many hours it was. Some of you could probably tell me how many hours it was. But anyway, a jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it. They put the sponge on a stalk of hyssop plant, and they lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head, and he gave up his spirit. That's in John 19, 29 to 30. The apostles stood nearby. They bewildered and forlorn, watching from afar as Jesus was crucified. Their Messiah was dying, and so were their hopes. All their expectations were crashing down like the walls of Jericho. They depended upon Jesus. He led them and mastered taught to them. From their safe vantage point, they saw Jesus turn to one of the other victims and say something to him, but they couldn't make out his words. One of the other thieves on the cross, they just couldn't tell what he said to him. Perhaps it's that way with you sometimes, as it is with me when standing at a distance from Jesus, it's difficult to hear what he's really saying. But then Jesus shouted with a loud voice so all could hear, "It is finished." That the apostles could hear. One word in Greek, three words in English, it is finished. Concise, crisp, and neat. But what did the Savior mean? What was finished? Jesus was declaring that the work God had assigned him was now complete. The work that God had assigned him. God's plan for our redemption was finally realized. The strategy he formulated before the foundation of the world was at last culminated. The grand scheme of redemption, so patiently woven through the ages, was now accomplished. From God's calling of Abraham to the miraculous birth of Jesus and his teachings, signs, and miracles, all of it had reached its zenith in the crucifixion of Christ. It's all been planned all these years. That's what was finished. His cry from the cross was not the moan of the defeated. It's not a whispered resignation to death, but the roar of victory. His exultant cry of the Godhead, the greatest note of triumph that ever sounded in the ears of a startled universe, were the words of Christ from the cross when he said, "It is finished." So what does this mean for us as we take part in the Lord's Supper? It means we can celebrate that Christ was not the victim, but he was the victor. He overcame the serpent's devious strategy in Eden and the temptations in the desert. He took everything Satan could throw at him, including the farce of a trial and a criminal's death, and still he won through all that. It means that the sacred meal is a reminder that in Christ, we too are no longer victims. The blood of Jesus was free us, has freed us, and made us victorious. It means as we take communion, we can be confident that God's immeasurable grace has paid our debt and erased our guilt. It means our Father is steady, unwavering through the centuries, always dependable and persistent. What we set out to do, he completed. Nothing, not even Satan himself, could deter our Father from his plan to redeem us, a people for his own possession. He is the Lord God Almighty and worthy of our praise, especially as the Lord's table, for we participate in the most sacred act of Christian worship. It is here that we commemorate the sacrificial death of his Son and recall the last words that Jesus thundered before he bowed his head in victory. It is finished. A lot of meaning there. A lot of meaning. So, as we partake today, always remember that it was the culmination of a great plan that God had. And his Son had to pay the price for all of us on the cross. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for everything that you've done us, especially the greatest sacrifice that could have been made. We ask today as we meditate and contemplate what we should be doing in our lives, that you watch over us and care for us and be with us every day. We ask these things in your heavenly name. Amen. As they were in the upper room preparing to eat, and Jesus took the bread and he blessed it. And he said, eat of this bread and receive me in your body. And after passing the bread, he passed the cup. He said, this is my blood. Drink of it and receive the new covenant. Have a good week.
I forgot last week I was supposed to do this. But I come to talk about the Coats for Kids drive that we're having in October. We're taking donations now. And last year was a great success. I keep telling everybody we gave away over 400 articles, sweatshirts, vests, coats, and caps and gloves, and the kids were thrilled. So if you have something in your closet that you haven't been using, adult items are welcome. There's some big kids out there that really do wear adult clothes, and then many times the parents need just as much as the kids. And so we don't limit, we accept sweatshirts, vests, coats of any size that are good, and even if they're used, we don't need new coats necessarily at all. Also, I wanted to mention there's a townwide coming up. If you like to rummage, you might look for some coats. They would come in handy at a reasonable price. That's the thing. So I will have a sign-up sheet for workers. The 23rd of October will be the day we set up, and the 24th through the 27th will be the days that will be open to the kids to pick up coats. So if you have any ideas about advertising or drop-off spots or working, just come and talk to me or Jody Rush, and we'll be glad to work with you on whatever ideas you may have, because we want another successful drive, and I think the need this year is even greater than last year. So thank you.
Morning. Joy wanted me to have a prayer for the offering and pray for this undertaking we're taking. I think it's great. I've been going around with Loretta different places finding coats. It's a lot of fun. Got to eat out too. But we had a good time.
We keep our show on the road.
We sure do. But let's bow our heads now and thank God for everything He's given us and for this offering that we can use to help our community and our church to draw more to you. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity we have to come to you in prayer, and we thank you, Father, for the tithes and gifts that have been given. We pray, Father, that we use to build your kingdom and to bring the souls to thee. Guide us and direct us, and we be, Father, also with our endeavors, that we make sure that we put ourselves first in love to help others. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Oh, it is great to see you all this morning. I will tell you, if you get the opportunity to help with the coat drive, it is a really cool opportunity to be here and to get to meet some of the families and the kids who are needing coats and to talk to them. It is a very awesome thing. I encourage you to pray about that and think about that in the next coming weeks on if you can help with that or not. But today, we come to the close of our series, I Have a Question, where we've been looking at different questions people have about church and about Jesus and about faith, and how do we answer those as Christians when people ask us those outside of the church. And the last question I want to get to in our series is actually a question that I have been asked by people here in the church over the last couple of weeks. This question that I have been asked is one that even one person asked me as they were walking out the door, and many of you probably have this same question. The question was, Joey, you've given us a lot of answers to these questions, but how do I take that answer and share it with somebody? How do I do that? What does that look like to actually sit down and have a conversation? Because it just sounds like a lot. Am I supposed to repeat your whole sermon? What do I do? How do I do all of this together? And you know what? It's a good question. That is a very good question, because it's one of the harder questions for us to answer. And as ministers, we can give you all the answers, but how do you put that into practice? And I really got to thinking about it, because the Bible tells us not just to know the answers, but if you remember, we started this series with 1 Peter 3:15. In your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect. So it says, always be prepared to give an answer, not just to have an answer, but be prepared in how to do it in gentleness and respect. How to do it in a loving way, in a way that will encourage them, not beat them up. And so I've been thinking through this the last couple of weeks. Okay, how do I preach a sermon on this and tell people how to do this? And the more I got to thinking about it, sometimes the best way to learn is by watching. Not just by doing, not just by hearing it in a sermon, but sometimes the best way is to see it played out. So, Bob, to answer your question, why do we have this like this today? We are actually going to be doing this just a little bit differently. Oh, there we go. Okay. We're going to be doing this a little bit differently. And today, me and Guy are going to have a conversation. And Guy has asked that I please remind everybody, this is Guy acting like someone who is not in church, not necessarily everything that Guy says and believes. But I want to show you what this looks like to have that. So this is going to be as if we are sitting at a coffee house, just sitting there, and the conversation just starts. So I hope you enjoy, and I hope this encourages you and helps you today. I do. I've got a seat right up here. Yep. Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm reading the Bible. I'm catching up on my Bible reading plan before I head to church, but I got to read it real quick. Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, I am. I'm one of those Christian people. What about you? What? Well, can I ask you a question? All right. Why don't you really believe in God?
How do you believe in something you don't see? I mean, oh, so you read something in a Bible, okay? How do you believe in what you don't really see?
Actually, hey, I've got this card right here. It's got some Bible verses and stuff, but actually, it goes into exactly why I believe what I believe. You got time? Can I share some of this with you?
Oh, I guess. I was just gonna go listen to some guy talk. It's in the morning, but okay, yeah.
All right. Well, yeah. Let's take some time. First, I want to start with, you see this image right here? That is a sun. And the first thing is that God created light and God created everything, right?
Okay, so who's this John guy?
John? Well, that's right here. John 1:1-3. All right, this is what it says. This is what the Bible says. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. This is all about how God created everything. And so for me, when I look out and I see that I'm alive and that there's a creation, I go, man, there has to be a God. This is why I believe in God, is because of the things he created.
Okay, so how do you know he created it? I mean, really?
Well, that's a good question, right? Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
How do you know the guy that said he made these cars?
Because you can see him.
Because you can see him. Yeah, you can see him. And you know someone had to make it. The cars just didn't move out of nowhere, right?
Yeah, right.
So that's the same thing with God. In Romans 1:20, it says this. Since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuses. You like fishing, right?
Well, yeah.
And you like to sit out there at the pond, and you see all that around you, right?
Right.
And it all works together. If you take something out of that pond's going to get scummy. You take too many fish out, it all falls apart, right? The ecosystem.
Okay, yeah.
Do you think something that just happened out of nowhere?
I always thought it did.
That sounds crazy, though, right? To think the way the world is made is even more intricate than a car, right? Everything works even more well than better than a car, right? It works better than a car. But here's the deal. You look at that, I look at it and go, man, something had to create this. That to say that it just happened out of nowhere, that is crazy to me.
Well, that's what I've always been taught. I mean, in science and biology, it's like revolution or whatever they call that, you know?
Yeah, I know, the evolution, they've got all that. But when you look at it, if you really just look at it, it's easy to go, man, something had to make this. When you really get down to thinking about it, something had to make this. And you know what, for me, when I look at it, I go, there has to be a God. And then on top of it, when I started reading the Bible, there was this guy, Jesus, right?
Okay.
Yeah. And so you've got Jesus who's introduced, and Jesus is God's son. And Jesus came down, and the one thing we know from historians and the Bible and everything, Jesus was a real dude. And if everything Jesus says in the Bible is real, this is what we're told in John 1:14. All right? It says this. Yeah, right there. Mm-hmm. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. We've seen who God is because of Jesus, because of what he taught. Everything in the Bible, it all points to God. But I think the thing for me, Guy, is that it doesn't just point to a God who created everything and is all powerful, but it points to a God who is full of grace and truth, a loving God. It shows us who God is. And in that, I really got to thinking about this, and that's why for me it starts to stick out. But one of the things that I kind of struggled with, and I don't know if you've struggled with this, it's easy to say I believe what the Bible says, but it's just a book, right? Because you probably believe everything in here, and have you ever gone to look at a car and it be a lemon?
Oh, yeah.
It's not exactly what it says it is, right? So one of the things for me is it's not just that I've read it in the book, I look in creation. I've also got Jesus' spirit in me. I've seen God at work. All right, let me explain by showing you a verse.
Yeah,
can I show you a verse?
One.
All right. So in John 14:26-27, it says right here, "But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." You see, here's the deal. It says that in the Bible, right? It says, if I follow Jesus, and we'll get into kind of what that looks like on how to follow him, but when I do all these things, I receive the Holy Spirit. Well, this Holy Spirit in you, he actually comes in and gives you peace and guidance. And I will tell you, for me personally, I've seen God at work in my life. Who I was is not who I am now. You've probably seen some of that. I'm not the same guy I was when you first met me, right?
Yeah, you're kind of crazy.
I am. But as I've changed, crazy, but the other thing too, Guy, is I've got this peace. That even when life is crazy, I have this peace inside of me knowing that God is with me and that God's in control of everything. And it's not like, all right, before I go into this situation, I need to try to do, I don't have to do all that. I just pray and God's in control. I'll tell you, even when I was in war and I was getting shot at, I had peace.
Really?
Yeah. And it's all because of God. But what do you think about that? What are your thoughts?
Well, it sounds good. I mean, I don't know if I really still believe it all, but what you're saying is making sense to me a little bit. But how do you have true peace when there is so much evil in the world? I mean, why doesn't God just create all? Why did He create all this evil? Why did that happen?
All right. Well, first off, let me point to you. See that? Looks like a split in the road.
Yeah, it looks like you're turning left or right.
Yeah. Okay, so basically that turning left or right, God created everything to be good and perfect, going straight, going perfect. But man messed up. He made man and woman, and He said, don't eat from this tree. Yeah. And if you do, it'll mess everything up. If you don't, everything will be good. And they chose to eat from the tree. And what we're told in Romans 5:12, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in his way, death came to all people because all sinned. So death and wickedness and evil entered the world because of man's decision. Not because God created it, not because God said, let this happen. No, man decided to do that. And here's the other part. It says all have sinned. Guy, have you told any lies?
Well, yeah.
All right. Have you ever deliberately made your wife mad?
No.
No?
Okay, maybe.
All right. There are things we've done, right? Have
right.
We disobeyed our parents when we were younger. We've all messed up. Well, when we decide to do that, and we decide to go the wrong way, we are separating ourselves from God. And we're separating ourselves from what's good. And because of that, that's why there's so much wickedness and evil and sin in the world. That's why there's death. And here's the other part of that. When something happens, there's always a consequence, right?
Yeah. Mary doesn't cook.
When you make her mad, she doesn't cook, right? So when these types of things happen, there's consequences. And sometimes, if you were to bring her flowers, or I know you've been working on that.
That's a great idea.
That flowers. Building that room for her, right, at the house. You've been trying to build that room.
Oh,
for
yeah.
Her.
Yeah.
So if you were to finish the room for her, she'll probably cook. She'll give you back massages. She'll do.
Ooh.
But there's good and bad consequences depending on what we do. Romans 6:23, right here. Says, for the wages of sin is death. So the consequence of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So there's two options. We're all going to sin and mess up, and the consequence of that is this. But Jesus has said, I want to give you a gift. So what do you think there?
Well, it's kind of interesting. All right, how about this? So why doesn't God just get rid of all the evil? Why? I mean, He's God.
Mainly because if God got rid of all the evil, guy, you and I have evil in us, right? Because we've sinned.
Mm-hmm.
That wipes us out. Actually, that wipes everybody out, doesn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
That would take everybody out. And John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. And then verse 17 says, for God didn't send His Son into the world to condemn the world. So He didn't send it to send all of us to hell, right? He didn't come to do that, but to save the world through Him. God doesn't want to destroy us. I know that's what some people believe, is God sitting up there with thunderbolts and throwing thunderbolts down, wanting to light people up. He actually wants to save us from evil. That's His whole plan from the beginning. And 2 Peter, way back here, 2 Peter 3:9 says this, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. You notice that all. He's wanting all to reach repentance, or to turn from their sins and turn from this life of evil and wickedness and go in a good direction. What do you think?
Well, I've always seen that 3:16. You watch football games and there's people got plastered on their forehead. I never understood what that was about, but I'm starting to see it now. It's like, wow, really? So he loved us and wants to save us.
Yeah, that's the whole reason he sent Jesus, because he loves us and wants to be reunited with us in a relationship with us. That's why Jesus came and died for the forgiveness of our sins, right? He came down to earth, and in 1 Corinthians 15:1-3, it says, "Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." You see, Jesus came down right here, but on top of it, he also died for us. He died for the forgiveness of our sins. What do you think?
That's pretty cool, really, if you really think about it. I mean, why would he die for me? For my freedom? Also, why is his death a big deal? I don't know. It's interesting. That's good stuff.
Yeah. Well, can I tell you why his death is a big deal?
Yeah, tell me.
Okay, so his death is a big deal because he didn't just die. He beat death.
How'd he do that?
He rose from the dead. 3 days later, this picture right here, that is the sign of an empty tomb. All right, so where they buried him, they came back 3 days later and the body was gone. He was risen from the dead. 1 Corinthians, if we continue on, 15:4-7 says this: "He was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." But here's the deal. You ready? It wasn't just that he was raised from the dead, because people say that about Tupac and Elvis, right? They're still alive. So
they're not?
No. There's no real proof, right? Well, when you keep reading in verse 5, it says, "In that he appeared to Cephas," which was one of his disciples, "then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles." He's appeared to all these different people. So it's not just that he rose from the dead. There are so many different accounts. Jesus was alive, that he really did raise from the dead. This ain't a conspiracy theory thing. So that's how we beat death, is he raised from the dead. And that also means that we can have eternal life, that he can help us beat death.
So he died.
Yeah.
And then he, 3 days, he raised himself. So, like, if I die, can I do that?
Well, not in 3 days.
Okay, if I can't, then if he died, he raised himself in 3 days, then that's pretty cool. So why don't we see him? Well, you said you had him living in you, but, I mean, I want to see this guy walking around. Why can't I?
Yeah, that would be easier to believe, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
definitely. You could see him. Well, here's the deal. Jesus, before he died and then before he went back up into heaven, he told his disciples, "I'm going somewhere. I'm going to my Father," or up to heaven, "to prepare a place for you." So he's actually gone back to heaven right now, and he's getting heaven ready for all those who follow him. And we know this because in Acts 1:9-11, it says this: Jesus has already been raised from the dead. He's been walking around with them. He's been teaching them, talking with them, appeared to everybody. And he said, after he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This is the same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven. Will you come back? He will come back in the same way you've seen him go into heaven." You see, Jesus went into heaven to prepare this place, to get everything ready, but it says he's coming back. He's coming back, and Jesus tells us in Matthew 24, verse 40, "So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." So he's coming back, but he never told us when. He just says, be ready. And we need to make sure that in being ready that we've accepted this gift of forgiveness and we've got a right relationship with him before he comes back. Because if not, that's when he comes back and he says, those that have a relationship with me, here you go. Those come on up into heaven for eternal life. Those that don't, here's the consequence of the choice you made. What do you think? What,
right.
I mean, I know this is a lot.
Yeah, I'm saying kind of getting interested. This is pretty cool. All right, let's just say I wanted to follow Jesus.
Okay.
And wanted to be forgiven. What I need to do to fix my life. I mean, I've had some things in my life bothering me going on. Shouldn't I go take care of that first? Shouldn't I go fix my life myself?
No, here's the deal. A lot of people think that, right?
Yeah.
Because you got to get this stuff fixed before you can go and do this. But really what God says is, I accept you as you are. Come to me first. Come to me with your brokenness.
Okay.
But then I'll help fix you. Romans 5, 6 through 8 says this. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That's us,
that's
right?
Me.
That's,
yep. Okay.
Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Wow.
Isn't that crazy?
That's, yeah.
That he didn't say, all right, well, get yourself in shape first, then I'll die for you. He said, I will die and offer you this gift of forgiveness.
Yeah, because what was it? So you mentioned 2,000 years ago, I wasn't even around. So that's crazy. How could he have died for me? That's just insane.
Yeah.
It blows me away.
I know. He says, I want to give you this gift. You need to accept this gift.
Okay. How do I get that gift? I mean, how do I get this free gift? I don't see it wrapped up. I'm, holding the box.
Yeah.
So.
Well, here's the. I wish I could. That would be pretty cool.
Yeah.
If I were to say, when I hand you
cool.
the box.
Yeah.
Well, it actually starts with believing and confessing. All right. You see this little megaphone right there?
Okay.
Believing and confessing, being willing to say, I believe that God is. Everything we've talked about. I believe there is a God. I believe Jesus did come. He is the Son of God. He came and died on the cross for me. I believe all of that, and I'm willing to say it out loud. And the verse there, Romans 10:9, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So that's the starting point, right? You've got to start there, but then it keeps going on. Because you don't just start there. In Romans 6:12, it tells us what you have to do next. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? You see this picture right here? How it's like a turnabout?
Oh, uh-huh.
Turn around. That's basically what God is saying. He says, I want you to believe and confess, but then I want you to turn from your sins. Not just say, I confess that I believe in God, but I believe that he can change me. I want to change. I want to leave this old life. I want to get rid of the stuff that I was doing wrong.
So I can't go undoing it. I can't.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't go undoing it.
I know, I was kind of having a good time.
I know it is.
I was having a good time.
But again, I was telling you, what God's done in my life since he's changed me,
Well, I have seen that in you.
Has been very good, and it's brought me more joy. It's brought me more joy and peace getting rid of some of that stuff. Some of it seemed fun, but I'll tell you, guy, a hangover is a hangover.
Well, yeah.
It ain't fun afterwards, is it?
No.
That's why there's so many people drinking coffee, right? Well, here's the thing. He says, turn from that, and then, on top of it, get baptized.
Get baptized?
Yeah.
What's that?
It's going into water and being dunked and coming up, right?
I already had a bath.
You already had a bath?
Yeah.
Well, I mean,
maybe not.
I get it. It does sound kind of goofy, doesn't it?
Okay.
Why? Because all the other stuff makes sense, but why do we need baptism? Romans 6:3-4. So we read 1 and 2. Let's keep going down. Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. You see, this baptism, it's not to wash us off or take a bath. It's not that. It's literally for the forgiveness of our sins. And the other thing on top of this, in Acts chapter 2, they asked the same question, what must we do to be saved? Mm-hmm. And in Acts chapter 2, what he told them, Peter tells them, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. So when you're baptized and you say, I'm ready to do this, Jesus says, what you're doing is demonstrating the death and resurrection. So dying to your old sins, coming up.
So I'm not really dying.
No, you're not really dying.
Okay.
Just if I hold you down too long. That may happen. But you're not really dying, right? So, but you're dying to your old self. You're saying,
right,
I'm leaving the old self. And when you come up, this is Christ saying, this is where you're forgiven. This is this is where forgiveness starts. And I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, this thing I've been talking about, into you so that you can live this new life. Because it's really hard to turn away from sin. It's hard to give up some of our bad habits, right?
Yeah, I'll give you that one.
So he says, I'm going to send someone to help you in that. And then in this new life, Romans 6:5-6, you can dig down a little further. For if we have been united with him in a death like this, he will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. That it's not just saying we want to turn from, but we'll actually begin turning from that. And we'll begin to live this new life as a new person. People will say I'm crazy, but they'll also say I'm different, right? I'm different than what I was.
Mm-hmm.
But I know this, again, I'm throwing a lot at you. Where are you at on this?
Well, there's a lot, like I said, it's a lot to take in. Makes a lot of sense. Okay, let me ask you this. I get baptized, I have the Holy Spirit. Do I have to be perfect? Do I have to live this perfect life?
No.
Can I?
No. No one can be perfect, right? The Holy Spirit comes in us and still guides us, but you're not going to be perfect. You're not going to have all the answers right away. Some people think that as soon as you're baptized, you come up and go, and now you walk up. But think about it. Have you ever seen anybody without sin?
No. No. I've seen Christians. That's why I was bringing that up. There's a lot of Christians out there that act this all righteous person attitude on Sunday, and then on Monday you hear something about them. That's why I was asking that.
Well, and that's the thing is, we as Christians, we're going to mess up, but our goal is to keep learning and growing in Christ. And that's why I'm sitting here reading the Bible today. And that's why I was going to go to church.
Oh, that makes sense.
And Romans 6:17 says this, but thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You've been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. So
I become a slave.
Well, that slave, it's more like a chosen servant. You choose to serve righteousness. Right? I know slave has a bad connotation.
Yeah, it does.
But it's really saying, I choose to follow. What are you following? What are you making the most important thing? I choose to follow Christ and what he teaches.
Okay.
That's what all that comes down to. And I want you to know this guy. I don't just believe this, like I said, because it's all written in this book. It's not just because it's in the book. I believe it because I see God at work around me and in me all the time. I've experienced this joy. I've experienced this peace. I've experienced all of this.
And even on times when I have anxiety and I feel like, oh, stressed out, when I pray and turn to God, he takes it all away. I can't even describe what it's like, but it's like nothing else. It's even better because I know sometimes people go and drink so that they can get rid of the anxiety, but the crash afterwards and everything else, I never have any of that. It's always just peace. It's fantastic, and I've seen that in Christ, and I share this with you, and I've talked to you about this not because I think I'm better than you. I don't want you to think that, because I've messed up a lot. You know my mistakes. You know I'm not perfect. But I come because I want you to know what I know. I want you to have this same thing. I want you to know that I care about you, that God cares about you and loves you. And I want you to experience this freedom. I want you to experience this joy and peace that I talked about. What do you think?
Yeah, I never realized what the Bible actually said. It's pretty interesting. I never thought about God loving me as much to actually care that much for me to send a son. There's a lot there, and I didn't realize he was trying to save me. I was always out there saving myself, however. So you give me a lot to think about, and I appreciate it. I really do. It means it makes me feel like you care, yeah. And that's cool. That's a good feeling.
I do. And guy, if you're not ready, if there's a lot to think about still, and you're not ready to make a decision, I understand that. And I want you to know, if you have any questions at all, feel free to call me. Feel free to text me. You got my number. And I want to also, if you're sitting there and going, I want to hear a little more. I want to invite you to church. We can't go today. We missed church today. But Sundays at 10:15, we've got church service. If you want to come with me, I'd love to have you come with me. And if you ever get to a point where you decide, I'm ready to accept Christ, I'm ready to make that decision to accept that gift of forgiveness. If you ever get there, call me any time or day.
Okay.
I am there.
I feel something. I mean, I'm feeling something pulling, and it's like I said, you gave me a lot to think about. I never realized what the Bible actually meant, what it had to say. I've never read it, so, RVs, cars, and trucks are pretty cool, too, but that's a lot better, sounds like. I'll die in one of these in a car wreck and I'm dead. It sounds like if you die in the Bible, going down the baptism route, you live. That's pretty cool. Well, I'll call you sometime. I'd like to think about it.
Right.
I know it's, wow. My head's swimming. So.
Well, I'm here for you no matter what.
Appreciate it, Joe.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I'm going to get to work.
All right.
Good day.
I hope this encouraged you. All right. I hope you see how casual it can be and how you can just have a conversation. And just by following through and talking to people and getting to know them, you can share this message. And you can see that if you're prepared, you're ready. And what I want to encourage you is, all of you got these, and you may be wondering, where's the Bible reading plan this week? This is it. And what I want to encourage you to do is read this. Read these this week and go over in your mind. Maybe you've got someone that you've been wanting to witness to. Look for the opportunity in the conversation when it comes up. Have this ready and be willing to sit and talk to them about it. And I also want to say, if you are here and maybe you have not made that decision yet, maybe you felt like I was talking to you, that you and I were just having this conversation. If that's the case and you want to make a decision, I'm ready. God's ready if you want to make that decision. But if you want to talk more about it or you have questions, again, that offer, my number is in the bulletin. Call me at any time. I would love to talk to you. The elders' numbers are in the bulletin. They would love to talk to you. But please, please reach out. Would love to answer any questions you have. And I hope in all of this you all know how much God loves you and loves others and how we are to share that in the same way. You pray with me. Dear God, we come today thanking you. Thanking you, Lord, for your love. And Lord, thanking you that not only have you loved us and offered us this gift, but Lord, you've offered it to everybody. Even those of us that are a little worse off than others. You're so good, God. And I want to say, Lord, I'm sorry for times that I have not been prepared. And Lord, I pray that for all of us, that you prepare us so that when we have opportunities, that we not only have answers that we can just throw at people, but we've got gentleness and your love and your passion that we can share with others in a way that shows them your love for them, Lord. Because then our goal in life is to live in a relationship with you and to bring glory to you. And we know the best way in doing that is sharing your message with others so that they too may know and hopefully make that decision to follow you as well. Lord, you're so good. Your mercy endures forever, and I thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You will stand with us as we sing.